everyone, and welcome to Yarngasm. I'm Kristen, and this is episode 200, part 2. If you are just tuning in, you might want to watch part 1 so you're all caught up, but this is the part of the podcast where I answer a bunch of Ask Me Anything questions from the 200th episode Ask Me Anything thread. And just to reiterate, there were so many questions in that thread that I just chose a handful of them and separated them by knitting related, dyeing related, business related, sewing related, and miscellaneous, just to give you a heads up. But I just wanted to say, just to follow up on my sad shawl news yesterday. I know I shared my Loden shawl did not exactly pan out, so I was kind of on the prowl for another feel good, pick me up type of shawl to cast on and knit. And you guys, I found one. So yay, happy shawl news today. And this is totally random. I've never seen this shawl before on Ravelry. I was just kind of, when you browse Ravelry, there are just, you know, the usual suspects. There's the hot right now patterns, there's the most popular, most projects, yada yada. So I decided to take things to Pinterest, and I just typed in, I think it was, what did I type in? Just shawl triangular knitting on Pinterest, and a couple shawls popped up that were actually Russian. They linked to Russian websites. I'm assuming they were Russian, but I couldn't translate anything, but just popping a couple things into Google Translate, I was able to track it down on Ravelry, and I found this really beautiful lace triangular shawl pattern called the Sophia shawl, which I will put a photo of it right here so you know what I'm talking about. And it just literally took my breath away, and I had to cast on immediately. But yes, it's the Sophia shawl by, and I'm probably butchering this, Lyubov Shalnaya. And yeah, forgive me if I'm mispronouncing that. But I cast it on using some lace yarn, believe it or not. It does call for lace. And it's been quite a while since I've knit with lace yarn, but this is some yarn that I picked up from Gage Intention. And this is Northbound Knitting. I totally lost the label for it. I have no idea where it is. I actually used this when I was designing my shawl pattern, Vildis Mir, and it just didn't, I wasn't feeling the lace so much, so I switched gears to fingering. But yeah, once I saw this pattern, I immediately thought of this yarn, and it calls for beads as well, so it just had to happen. So here's where I am on it. So as you can see, I made a lot of progress on it last night, and let me see if I can get it to focus. There we go. So once this blocks out, it's just going to be beautiful. But you can tell, like, I already made like a significant amount of progress on it last night. And you guys, it's just so, it's not as intuitive as I was hoping for, but it's still exactly what I need. I'm just zooming through it, and every time I knit one row, I'm like, just one more row, one more row. And I'm just having so much fun knitting it. Clearly. And I was texting some friends, and I'm like, I think I found knitting nirvana. I can't remember the last time I just had so much fun knitting on something, or just so much. Yeah, it's definitely, this is my happy place right now. So I'm just having a lot of fun with it. And I'm using Knit Picks US size, I think, these are US size 3, which I'm not sure what is, it is in millimeters, but I should know. It's US size 3, 3.25 millimeter, I believe. So and these are Knit Picks, and you know, they work well. I'm not complaining about them, but I did go on Amazon and order myself some Chiagus just to make my knitting a little extra special. So those will be coming in the mail. I have Amazon Prime, so they should be here by the end of the day. So, which is exciting, because I get to, you know, and they definitely have a pointer tip, I believe, than the Knit Picks. So that'll make picking up the lace a little bit more easier, I guess. So we'll see. And yes, so I'm trying to think what else I want to say about this, other than I'm just having so much fun knitting it, and I'm so glad that I found it, and I highly recommend it if you are looking for a lace project to knit. Yeah, so yay for a new project that I'm excited about and having fun knitting. So without further ado, I am going to turn you over to Kristen of Yore from yesterday to answer some questions from the Ask Me Anything thread. But I just want to give you guys a little heads up. I do tend to scratch my nose a lot in this segment, and I apologize, it doesn't look very attractive, I know, but I think I had a serious allergy reaction to the fiber that I was holding that Allie sent me from Be Mice Elf. Not that it has anything to do with the fiber, it's just my allergies in general. Anytime I handle fiber, my nose just goes crazy and I have to itch it a lot. So apologies in advance. Then we'll move along to Blather, where I'll just give a little recap of what happened on 4th of July weekend. Okay, so first question, how did I learn to knit? Well, first I should probably precurse what I'm going to say. I'll give you guys a little background. My great grandmother was always knitting. She's from Oppenheim, Germany. I had gone over there several times when I was very young. I remember specifically I went over when I was 6 and she was always sitting in a corner knitting on a pair of socks, like nonstop, always knitting on something. And she even had a missing finger. How crazy is that? I don't know how she lost it. I think it was in a wood chopping accident. But yeah, she had, you know, a missing finger, but she was always knitting on socks and other things. My grandmother, I would go over with my grandmother and her sister, my aunt, and they weren't, my aunt would knit a little bit, but my grandmother, not so much. But I think I definitely got the gene from my great grandmother. And I didn't think twice about it when I was over there. You know, I would just go there and she was knitting. And ironically, her son, who, you know, they lived in the same house, he actually had a herd of sheep. So yeah, it was, if you can imagine, Oppenheim is pretty much very much in the country, you know, hills, lots of hills and valleys and everything. And yes, he had a herd of sheep across the road, which, you know, he kept and tended to, and they, you know, he sheared them and everything. Again, didn't think twice about it. I was 6, you know, and he actually kept bees as well, so they made their own honey. And very exciting times when I was over there. But I did not learn to knit until second grade, and I think I was about maybe 8 years old, where I was going to school in Manhattan in the city. I was going to an all-girls Catholic school at the time, and they had after-school classes. And I remember there was one class called Needles and Thread, and for some reason I just loved the idea of like learning to knit, learning to sew. And so they had these after-school classes that I had to take because my parents worked full-time, and my mom's like, okay, so which classes do you want to take? And I told her specifically I wanted to take Needles and Thread. That, you know, either art or pottery or needles and thread. And I think I was already involved in art and pottery or whatever, but needles and thread is something that I really wanted to do. My mom couldn't wrap her head around it. She says, why would you want to do that? That is, you know, like in her mind, like that was kind of like an old bitty thing to do. I don't know. I really don't know. But she wasn't keen on me like taking that class. But I actually remember throwing a tantrum, not a full on tantrum, but begging her to like let me take this class. So I took the class, had a blast. I learned to knit. I didn't really learn the whole cast on method, but we had this very nice French lady, super heavy accent, and I felt horrible, but we'd always make fun of her accent because she would always say, like, instead of here, it would be here. You do this here, you know? So, you know, being 6, you know, kids will be kids. But anyway, I remember her. She was a lovely instructor. And yeah, and I would, you know, take my knitting with me. I would go whenever I would visit my grandmother or my aunt. I would ask them, you know, I would be knitting on something. And then I was like, okay, now I want to change color. And my aunt would show me how to change color. And so I had so much fun with that. And but then, of course, the class ended. And, you know, of course, you know, being 8 years old, you kind of throw it to the wayside a little bit. But I didn't give it too thought, you know, I didn't think about knitting again until maybe like in high school, where I remember I was in Barnes & Noble, a bookshop. I'm not sure if it's everywhere, but Barnes & Noble is a popular bookshop in the States, at least that I know of. And I was browsing their, you know, bargain section, and they had a kit on learning to knit. So I was like, wow, that, you know, I've knit for ages. So I picked up this kit. But I remember it clearly. It was a little kit, it was a box, and then it had bright yellow acrylic yarn, and it had hot pink acrylic yarn and matching hot pink knitting needles, which I thought that I had, but I think I passed them down to my my cousin, who was interested in knitting at some point. I don't know if she's knitting today, but anyway. Yeah, but I remember this, and I taught myself. I was so proud of myself. And then, of course, it fell to the wayside again. And then I stumbled on, I believe I got really into it. There may have been a little gap, but then Debbie Stroller came out with Stitch and Bitch, which is pretty much a knitting Bible by this point. I think it's a classic. You should, if you know, it's probably in every knitter's library or most knitter's libraries, but really fun book on, you know, teaches you how to knit and purl and everything. So first came the kit, and then came Debbie Stoller's Stitch and Bitch. And then I would purchase, I didn't know any better, you know, the different types of yarns were out there. So I was buying like the cheapest, you know, acrylic yarns and what have you. Nothing fancy. I was knitting things that are projects that I found on craftster.org. That was huge way before Ravelry. And I even started a blog at that point. I was Woolen Whiskey, which was kind of like, you know, play on, I don't know if you guys know the band Belle and Sebastian, but they have a song called Winter Whiskey. So I just combined, like I do a lot of things when I'm coming up with names for things. But yeah, my handle on Craftster, which you could probably find if you really dive down there, is Woolen Whiskey. And I'll try and post a link to my old blog, which is still around, but I would just knit basic things. Like, I tried knitting the boob holder. I don't know if you guys know about that, but it's kind of like a simple bolero kind of shrug pattern by, I think it was Stephanie Japelle. I'm pretty sure it was. Did not really have much success with that because I'd never knit a sweater before. But yes, and what else was I knitting? Like scarves. There was some fun fur involved in there, but I did it smartly. I got this really cool fun navy and bronze Stellina fun fur, and then I combined it with some chunky wool and I made this really cool scarf. I'm still proud of it, even though it was fun fur. And then I also made, oh no, that didn't come till later, but I made some scarves for my dog. I made some leg warmers. I made some mittens. I made some hats. So, you know, nothing too terribly complicated, very basic stuff, but I was having a lot of fun with it. And then of course college happened, and preparing for finals for high school and then college. Knitting made a reappearance at some point. I remember I actually knit a bikini top. I would continue knitting hats and whatnot, but then, you know, it was on and off, and unfortunately it did kind of fall to the wayside for several years. But then it really came back into my life after, I think, around 2007, when I was laid off from one of my very first real jobs as a video editor, which I'll talk about later. But I had gotten laid off from my job. It was during the summer. I remember it was like right before Easter time, and I pretty much, for the whole summer, I had the whole summer off, like looking for jobs, but in between there was like a lot of dead time between sending out resumes and everything. And then randomly, I wasn't even thinking about knitting, but randomly I had gone into a 99 cent store in our neighborhood, and I stumbled on, when I walked in, they had a huge bin of this chenille, I think, oh gosh, who makes it? I'm not sure if it's like Bernat. I think Bernat chenille yarn. It was in this really cool peacock blue. And I'm like, it's been so long since I knit and I have all this time on my hands. So I was like, when I saw that bit, I just got super excited and of course stocked up. I think I got like two or three skeins of it. So I bought it, and then I remembered I had my original knitting needles, my hot pink knitting needles from my my kit that I had bought years ago in my drawer. Go figure. They were in my desk drawer, and I was like, all right, you know, so I'll just play a little bit. And then of course I go on the internet and start looking up. I go to craftster.org and everything, just browsing some knitting patterns, and then Ravelry, which was unbeknownst to me until that point. And I discovered Ravelry and signed up. I think it was beyond the waiting list point. I'm not quite sure, but anyway, I got an account. And I was just like, a part of me was like, I want to be part of this community. This seems really awesome. This is an awesome thing, you know, but I was just kind of like, it just made knitting that much more exciting for me. Like, I just bought yarn. I want to knit with it. I need to find patterns. And then I discovered Ravelry and I'm like, whoa, mind is blown. I want this to be a thing. So that was definitely like the seed, if you will, or like the point where the clicking point where I just became insane and obsessed about knitting. And I will say that I actually kept knitting a secret from Dennis for quite some time. I think like a month or so. I just would knit, and then we were still dating. So I was living at my place, and when he would come over, I would just hide it. You know, he had a key to my place. So I was just like, you know, he would come over and I was like, I hear him come in. I'm like, I just, hid the knitting, you know, and then one day I think he discovered it. I don't know if I just came out with it and said I was knitting or whatever, but I think he, you know, some form or way he discovered that I was knitting, and he's like, oh, my mom knits. She's very into fiber arts and everything like that. I'm like, oh. So I've been like freaking out, like not freaking out, but you get what I'm saying. I just felt the need, like, oh, I should probably keep this a secret, you know, because it's such a weird and like an obscure hobby to have, you know. A lot of people go biking, a lot of people go hiking. I'm knitting, you know. So anyway, but that was cool. He accepted the fact that I knit and appreciated the fact that I knit. So I let my knitting pride flag fly high and strong. So anyway, I feel like I'm rambling on a lot about this. But yeah, that was pretty much how I really got into knitting. All right, I promise these next questions aren't gonna be as long-winded, but let me take a break and get a sip of water. And we're back. So, okay, the next question is, how and why did I start podcasting? Well, ever since I caught the knitting bug full on a couple of years ago, I think it was like 1 or 2 years where I had been knitting. I had actually found another job. I was working full-time again, and I had an accident. I had actually cut, if you had been following my blog, I had actually cut myself. I still have a scar today. I don't know if you've ever seen it on the podcast, but I was washing some dishes and a glass broke, and I cut myself really badly and needed stitches. And so I was home for, I think, like 2 days, because as a video editor, you know, I'm a job where I'm constantly using the computer and mousing around and typing. It was hard for me to use my hand, and I just needed that time to just kind of recover a little bit. So I was home, and I had been very into listening to the Knit Picks podcast, the Electric Sheep podcast, the Knit More Girls were on the list. So I was just like, you know, this seems a lot of fun. This seems like a lot of fun. You know, I could totally just start my own, because I had been blogging. I did have my blog. I don't even know if I even called it Yarngasm at the time, but I was home at the time, and I'm just like, you know what? I have a microphone, I have a computer, I've got nothing to do today, I can't knit, so let me take this for a whirl, you know. And it was horrible. Like my first podcast was, if you've been with me since the beginning, you probably know what I'm talking about, but the audio was bad. I sounded like Ben Stein, where I started out with a script and everything, and I was so nervous, and it was awful. But I did it, and you know, I don't have that recording today. I don't know what happened to it. I know when I switched from audio to video, it somehow got lost in the blogosphere or podcastosphere, whatever you want to call it. But yeah, that's how it initially started. And you know, the first time you do anything, it's always hard, and I knew that from the beginning. I'm like, you know what, this sucks right now, but the more and more I do it, I know I'm just gonna get more comfortable. So I stuck with it. It wasn't consistent, it wasn't weekly, because you know, I had a full-time job. It was, you know, kind of like whenever I had the time to do it. But that's essentially how I started podcasting. And so, but another reason I started podcasting was because, like I said, I had the blog, I was writing, I was posting photos and everything on there, but I will say writing does not come naturally to me. It's not one of my gifts, so to speak. And I thought, well, you know, maybe I'm better at speaking and, you know, talking about things, you know, maybe that comes more naturally to me than writing. And I loved it. It wasn't something that I had to go back and edit, other than, you know, editing out my ums and uhs and all, you know, stuff that flew past my filter, if you will. So I did like that aspect of it. And the switch from audio to video was pretty organic. It was just kind of like, you know, well, I saw a bunch of other people starting to do video podcasts and, you know, vlogs and what have you. And I was like, it'd be so cool to just show off what I'm actually talking about instead of just, you know, describing it. And I love that medium, especially because I worked in video, like editing and everything. I could just incorporate that, you know? So yeah, that is pretty much how I got into podcasting. And the next question is, how did I start dyeing yarn? Well, that I started doing when, just on a whim, basically. I had seen a couple of tutorials on how to do it, and it just started out as an experiment. You know, Lara from The Dyer's Notebook, I watch her podcast all the time, and she's always doing tutorials, and I was just like, that seems like a lot of fun. You know, let me give it a try. You know, so I watched a couple more tutorials online. And I was like, you know, all right, let me give it a try. I started small with food coloring. I had some yarn that I wasn't knitting with, and I just, you know, didn't like the color of it. So I'm like, let me see what happens when I play around with it. And the first time around, I just fell in love with the process. I'm like, this is so cool. I couldn't get over like how the dye just exhausts from the water into the fiber. And you know, I just started doing it a lot. I got some yarn from Knit Picks, berry yarn from Knit Picks, and went from food coloring and then graduated to acid dyes. And so I started out ordering berry yarn from Knit Picks, experimenting with those, and then I gradually started researching into where I could get some local undyed yarn. And it started, you know, it just grew from there basically. And suddenly all these skeins were just piling up and piling up and piling up. And then I was like, I'm obviously not going to be knitting these myself. So let me try putting these on Etsy and see what happens. And lo and behold, people were interested. People were buying them, interested, and it just kind of grew from there. So obviously I start, you know, once I got home from my day job, I would just come home, have fun, relax, dye a little, maybe like 10 to 20, you know, I think I was just dyeing like 10 skeins at a time whenever I had the time to do it. And then just putting them on Etsy, and you know, the demand became more and more, and then I was coming home and dyeing more and more, and then suddenly it was becoming like a juggle where it's like, you know, I was working full time, coming home, dyeing yarn and doing shop updates and everything like that. And it got to a point where I'm like, wow, I'm having a lot of fun doing this, but I'm having trouble keeping up with my regular job, which I will be honest, you know, it was a great job, but you know, lots of great benefits, great pay and everything, but I wasn't having fun anymore. It wasn't what I was passionate about. Obviously I was more passionate about knitting, dyeing, and making things, and I would just find myself during my downtime at work just browsing Pinterest, wishing I was making all the things. So it pretty much got to the point where I was working two jobs. I would come home from work after about like a 9 to 10 hour day, and get right to work dyeing yarn. And you can imagine how burnt out I kind of felt at, you know, the end of the week. And I would work on weekends too, dyeing yarn. So I'm like, it got to the point where I was like, all right, I'm having more fun dyeing yarn than I am at my actual day job. So I had to make a decision. And obviously I talked with Dennis about this. We did the math and we were able, you know, to figure out, all right, if I quit my day job and do yarn, we are able to still pay our bills and make a living, you know? So it's not like it was a snap decision. We're like, I'm done with this, you know? So it was planned. But you know, and I did save up, you know, enough where it was like, okay, I had a nice cushion, you know, I could quit my job and just slide into the next, you know, into dyeing yarn. So, but yeah, I've been doing it 2 years now. I quit my day job, obviously I gave him 2 weeks notice. I left October 24th and started dyeing yarn full time for Villain Vine Yarns the day after. So I think I did take like maybe like a day or two off just to kind of like celebrate and just craft a little bit and do all those fun things. But yeah, so that's the story of how I started dyeing yarn full time. But what did I do before for my day job, you ask? Well, I went to school for film and video at the School of Visual Arts in New York City, and I had gone into there wanting to be a director. Figured out that's not really what I wanted to do, so I studied cinematography. Not really what I wanted to do. So after realizing I didn't want to get into cinematography, I transferred into video editing, and bingo, I found my niche. So really fell in love with the process of editing video. I still really enjoy it. It's like putting little pieces of a puzzle together and doing tricks and everything. It's magic, basically. That is post-production. So anything that you do, any filming that I'm doing here is going to go into post-production. I'm going to work my magic and edit it so it looks all nice and pretty, even though I'm a hot mess right now while I'm recording, and probably saying some stuff that I was like, why did I say that? I can cut that out. So after I decided that editing was my thing, I stuck with it. After I graduated, I got a couple of video editing positions. The first one was for a band magazine, an online band magazine, which I'm not gonna like say which places I worked specifically, but yeah, that was a really fun job. I got to interview several bands and artists and then edit the video from that. And then I got laid off from there, which is really unfortunate because I really liked that job. Then I found knitting, and then I got another job at a very popular news corporation, which I will not say which, but for those of you that know me, you know what I'm talking about. So, but yeah, I was working at the non-political end of the spectrum, which I was very grateful for because I am the least political person you will ever meet. But yeah, I was working for their online magazine. It was a lifestyle magazine, so I signed up for video editing. But they were very, we were a small team, so I ended up having to wear a lot of hats. So while I was video editing, I was also producing, I was also scheduling, and pretty much dealing with PR people. And if you know me, I'm not that type of person. So it was very, very much introverted, and I don't like, doing that type of thing. So it just got to a point where I would have to take on so much responsibility, and I was just not having it. And it just made my job very difficult to, you know, wake up in the morning and just muster up the energy to actually go into the office and everything. But I did it. And I have no complaints about the people I worked with. They were wonderful. It just wasn't my thing. So very happy that I'm no longer doing that. Granted, there were a lot of fun times. I got to meet a lot of celebrities, and again, it was, you know, for their lifestyle magazine. So I got to, you know, interview some really interesting people. Including, I don't know if you remember, but I did interview the cast of Outlander, which was pretty much the highlight of my job there for 8 years. Granted, insane. So I interviewed the cast of Outlander, which was awesome. I got to interview Dita Von Teese. I got to interview, what's the guy from Sharknado? You know who I'm talking about, the guy from 90210. Anyway, I'm totally going off on a tangent, but yeah, those were some fun times. But it became a thing that I wasn't into anymore, and I'm happy just podcasting on my own, working on my own, and getting things done on my own. That's how I excel in what I do. So I don't know, teach their own. But so where do I dye my yarn? I dye my yarn in my kitchen at home. Well, the dream is to someday have my own studio. I dye in the kitchen that we cook in, but I do, obviously, I clean up before and after, you know, to keep things separated. So obviously I have separate pots for everything. So the pots that I dye with are separate from the pots that I cook in. I do I spend at least 15 to 20 minutes cleaning up before and after. I do the dishes, obviously, before I dye, I clean down the sink. And then after I'm done dyeing, I do the same. I clean down the counters and everything just to keep it all separated. But yeah, the dream is ideally to have my own studio one day. But yeah. So, wow, that was really long-winded, and I apologize, but I'm gonna move along to some business-related questions, because I have some of those, and I'm pulling these out of, all of these questions were pulled out of the 200th episode AMA thread, so I just kind of combined the ones that were frequently asked, and then I pulled some specific questions out from some Ravelry members. So I'm gonna start with dyeing business related questions, and Daja Winter wants to know, what I'm most curious about is your dyeing process, or rather how you like to do it. Like, do you always dye in the mornings or during the day? How many skeins do you dye in 1 week? Just about, I guess that probably varies. That when developing new colorways, do you just throw some colors together, or do you sketch them out? So I usually end up, I would like to get the dyeing done in the morning. It generally doesn't happen till later in the afternoon, like mid to late afternoon. Only because I'm still doing admin stuff in the morning, answering emails, labeling, skeining, and I just would rather have all that stuff done before I just relax and dye and get into the zone, if that makes any sense. So that's when I get my dyeing done. And generally I try to dye at least 30 skeins a day. That's what I have set up. That's what I'm set up to do. I could probably do more. But generally, given the time that I have, it takes me, I usually dye for like 3 to 4 hours out of a day. I will sit there and dye yarn. And yes, I have my main stove that I use, and then I have two separate coil burners that I plug into the wall, and those allow me to dye more yarn than I would with just the stove. I'm considering getting more burners. We'll see how that works out, because I am doing Indie Untangled, so if I have a couple more burners, that will allow me to bang out even more in one full swoop, if that makes any sense. So I'm able to dye, right now I'm able to dye at least 10 skeins at a time, given, like, because I have about like 6 burners going. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, yeah, about 6. So generally like 2 skeins per pot is basically generally what I do, although I could do more, but anyway. And let me see. And generally when I come up with colorways, I just on a spur, like, I will have it marinating in my mind, like, okay, this is what I'm thinking about for this colorway, and then recreate it in the pot. I don't do any sketching. Sometimes if I have a photo in mind, I will take it into Photoshop, color pick like the colors that are most appealing to me and try to create a palette out of that. But generally most of the time it's all just spur of the moment, in the moment, like, I want to create a colorway on this, here are the colors that I'm thinking about for it, and then I just go. So yeah, I hope that answers your question. And then Branwyn May on Ravelry, she asks, I'd like to ask about your branding, packages, labels, business cards, all the stuff you have beyond the yarn itself. For example, how do you make your labels? What considerations have you made regarding the way your yarn arrives to customers? Your aesthetic is beautiful, and the package I received when I ordered yarn from you was so lovely. Everything's so thoughtful. I'd love to hear about this aspect of your business. Thanks. Well, thank you. I'm so glad you love the packaging. And yes, I do everything I can to make the package as special as I can, because I know when I order from indie dyers or indie makers, I want it to have, you know, I just like adding that extra special touch, you know, to those packages. And, you know, I started out using, you know, like business cards with a pole punched in it and tying, you know, a red string around all the yarn, which I love that aesthetic. I love the way it looks, but it is rather time consuming. And since my business has, you know, grown the way it has, it's just very time consuming to do that to every skein. And I do dye like about maybe 80 to 100 skeins a week. So to do that, you know, it does take a lot of time. So I did move from the business cards to bookmarks, which I print out my logo and wrap and simply tape around, you know, and that just it just gives me back so much more time, so much quicker to do that. So, and I honestly, like, I like the way that looks much better than the hang tags. You know, they're neater, especially when you put them in, you know, granted, if you have them like stored the way I do right here, if the tag is hanging out, you can easily see what yarn that is, granted, you know, but, I don't know. I just, when I would ship yarn in the mail, I found those little business cards would get bent or crinkled or whatever, and I like the way the bookmarks hold up so much better when I ship them out. And yeah, I do use clear plastic bags. I like wrapping my yarn. I think a lot of yarn dyers do this too. They just wrap their yarn in, you know, some kind of protection, because, you know, when you ship it out in the mail, it gets exposed to the elements. And I don't know, I just like the clear plastic bags that I have, the cello, what do you call it, the cello bags. And yeah, so I think that is pretty much it. And, you know, I did, when I first started out, I would write a handwritten note to all my customers, as I wish I could do for everybody, every order that I get. But when I do have that many orders, it's pretty impossible to write thank you notes to everybody, even though I mean it from the bottom of my heart with every package that I send, you know. So I have little stickers that I, you know, put on every package that says thank you, even though, again, I wish those could be handwritten. They're not, but please know when you get a package, I am wishing that I could write a handwritten note to you guys thanking you every time you buy yarn from me, because it really does mean so much to me. So I do try to make it as personal as possible, you know, given the time that I have to actually package everything, because it does take time. So but yeah, and I'm trying to think. Okay, so I hope that answers your question. The next one is Cozy, is from Cozy Couch. She says, I'm a new viewer, lots of catching up to do. Did you ever dream you'd do this work, of creating art you love and make a living doing it, and that people would go crazy for your yarn? That would be, that there would be virtual card jacking, lol. Okay, yeah, it is quite crazy. I mean, I will say one of the pieces of advice my mother always, you know, she would always tell me, you know, Kristen, if you can do it, work for yourself, work for yourself. And that has always stuck with me. And that has always been a dream of mine, like to work for myself, be my own boss. I just never really knew how or what form that would take, you know. It's, and you know, once I found, you know, like once I started yarn dyeing and everything, I was like, you know, this is something I could probably do on my own and something that I enjoy and something I could manage. And it's art and it's something, you know, it's in the arena of things that I like to do, like knitting and, you know, creating and making, and it makes other people happy. And that's when I knew that that's pretty much what I wanted to do. But yeah, it was just totally unexpected. But I, you know, again, I'm super grateful. Anytime anyone buys yarn from me, it, you know, again, it means a lot. And yeah, I'm, you know, obviously very humbled by it. And I'm trying to think what else to say about it. But yeah, it was, I did not expect it to take off the way it did so quickly. And yeah, it's pretty awesome. So, you know, thank you. And yeah, cart jacking, another thing, is something that I wish I had control over, but I don't. It's something that happens with a lot of indie dyers, a lot of indie makers, when you go on Ravel, on Etsy especially. If you're not quick to snap it up, someone else has the potential to swoop in there and get it. And unfortunately, that is not something I have control over. So I apologize if that has happened to you on one or several occasions. I honestly, you know, wish I had power to do something about it, but there is not. So, but yeah, that's the way it goes, unfortunately. But once I do find a solution, believe me, I will figure it out, or try to figure it out. But yeah, so the next question is Julie RK Knits, from Julie RK Knits, and she says, congratulations on 200. What is your favorite thing about being a yarn dyer? I love how you were able to leave your day job and pursue your yarn business. Okay, thank you. And yeah, as I mentioned, the main thing about dyeing yarn is it makes other knitters happy. I love being able to see what other knitters and crocheters and makers do with my yarn. That is probably the most rewarding aspect of being a yarn dyer. But the process itself is just very enjoyable. It's zen. It's, I get to just kind of, you know, things that I'm inspired by, I get to just spew it out on yarn. If that sounds terrible, spewing it out on yarn, but it's just, you know, I get to interpret things that, you know, inspire me in yarn form, which is a medium I love to work with, if that makes any sense. And yeah, being my own boss, working out my own schedule, being able to take vacation whenever I want to, even though usually it's not really a full-on vacation, and just giving myself permission to do things, you know, being accountable for everything, and being able to work from home, because yeah, that I feel I work best when I'm at home, when I'm alone, and I get stuff done. I don't have those distractions like coworkers peeking over cubicles or coming in, or I'm expected to go to holiday, office parties or anything, or, you know, going away. It's just, not that I don't enjoy those things. It's, I feel like I get more accomplished when I'm on my own, if that makes any sense. But mainly, the joy of making other knitters happy and just enjoying the process itself is the big takeaway for it. Penny Gale wants to know, is there anything that still frustrates you with yarn dyeing? Anything you're still mastering behind the scenes? There are always things, you know, I choose my battles, I like to say. You know, it's like there are people who specialize in self-striping yarn, like Laura from The Dyer's Notebook, or Stacy from Mustache Yarns. They are, as far as I know, the queens of self-striping yarn. They are awesome and amazing. I prefer, while I've given it a try, my preferred method is submersion dyeing and speckling and, you know, the way I dye yarn. But, you know, even though it's, there are things that, you know, obviously I'm always learning, and I'm always, you know, looking into new techniques and what have you. There are some things that I would like to try now that it's summer. I would definitely love to try ice dyeing. That seems like a really fun way to dye yarn, although it can be time consuming, I imagine, because, and you have to have a lot of ice and bins and everything. But yeah, I'm trying to think. like I'm always looking for ways to become more efficient and without sacrificing creativity, obviously, and technique, and you know, without making it anything watered down. But yeah, I'm always looking for more efficient ways to dye. Right now I'm using twine to like tie up my skeins when I dye them. For a while I was using binder clips and everything because it would, my yarn wouldn't get tangled, but that proved to be not such a great idea because they were metal and they rusted and they kind of fell apart after being submerged in citric acid every once in a while. So, but yeah, again, always on the prowl for like more efficient ways to do things. Okay, so, oh, how do I decide which dyes to combine or put together to create a colorway? This is a collective kind of question. How do you decide which dyes to combine or put together to create a colorway? Or how do I describe my creative process? Again, like, as I mentioned, I either have an idea in my mind, which I just kind of play around with in the pot, or, you know, I have a photo or something where I color pick different colors from a photo to create a palette, or I just wing it sometimes. Mostly, you know, it's like I have an idea, like, okay, I like this color, I like this dye, so I throw it in the pot, and then I'm like, okay, this would look really cool if I had a splash of color here or this color, and I just kind of play around until I'm happy. Or it's not, they're not always perfect. It doesn't always go as planned, which is why I sometimes have one of a kind skeins, which are still knittable and they still look really cool most of the time. But you know, mainly it's just a lot of trial and error that I like, and it's fun doing that trial and error, and that's where I get the most joy, I think, coming up with new colorways and you know, writing down the recipes and then knowing that I can always recreate them. So I hope that answers your question. Okay, so we're gonna move along to knitting related questions, and this question is from Knitting in Nowhere. She wants to know, what are your favorite non-indie yarns? I love the beautiful multicolors and speckles out there, but I'm always on the lookout for good workhorse yarn too. Okay, so I do love Knit Picks. I've knit with Knit Picks a lot. They have very good workhorse yarn, especially sock yarn. Their stroll sock is definitely my favorite. Felici, obviously. And then their Wool of the Andes worsted is always a good workhorse yarn, and at a good price point too. I do love Cascade. Their 4-ply worsted is really great for cables and sweaters and what have you. And what else? Quince & Co. I don't think Quince & Co. can be considered, you know, it has that indie feel to it, but they are consistent yarn, so I will say that they're borderline, but they are my favorite, like, as far as the standard goes. And then Regia, or Regia, as, you know, as Germans like to call it, is easily becoming one of my new favorite go-to sock yarns. They have a lot of fun stuff, and I'm trying to look at my stash. Let me see. Yeah, I think that is pretty much it as far as like my fallbacks. Malabrigo too. I do love Malabrigo. It's so soft and so squishy. Definitely a great workhorse yarn, if you will, but with, you know, if you want a little artistic feel to it, tonal. But yeah, so I hope that answers your question. And then we have a question from Rosebob. Rosebob wants to know, what is on your knitting bucket list? What would you consider will be your legacy knit? Wow, that is a big question. Goodness, well, a pie shawl would be awesome. I know I've seen Carlene from the Made with Carlene Energy podcast, and Gabby from the Once Upon a Corgi podcast, and Denise from the Yarn Geek podcast. They've all been knitting on their Luca shawls, and I would love to knit a Luca shawl. Anything like intricate and lacy and like, where's that book? I cannot find it. It's, it's over there, but anything from knitted, like a giant stole from Knitted Lace of Estonia by Nancy Bush would be a legacy knit I'd consider. But I started knitting the Even Star shawl eons ago and never finished knitting it. So I would say a really elegant lace pie shawl or Estonian lace triangular shawl or something, that would be wonderful to knit. So Megan14 wants to know, I was wondering about your preferred sock knitting strategies. Do you prefer toe up or cuff down? I prefer cuff down. Though I've tried toe up, I always keep coming back to cuff down. I don't know why, it's just more pleasant for me. DPNs or magic loop? Magic loop. I do prefer DPNs on occasion. They are fun, they make me feel like a ninja sometimes, but honestly, I really prefer magic loop. They make sock knitting quicker, swifter. I'm not fiddling with knitting needles all the time. And they just helped my knitting of socks fly. And then she wants to know, what is your favorite heel? Right now I'm really into the Fish Lips Kiss heel. I just love the motions of it, but I do also prefer a reinforced heel flap and then turned heel, which I also, if you're not familiar, I do have a free pattern out for my favorite socks. You should totally download and check it out. Even if you're new to sock knitting, I definitely walk you through step by step on how to knit that type of sock. So yeah, definitely check it out. And then she also wants to know, also, what is your favorite sock pattern at the moment? Yeah, just a plain vanilla sock. You know, I always know I can pick up a sock and just knit it from memory. Yeah, vanilla all the way for the win, FTW. So, and then Dalmatian Mom 7 wants to know, have you ever tried knitting two socks at a time and how did it go? Yes, I did try knitting two socks at a time. Mina from the Knitting Expat podcast, when she was in town for Vogue Knitting Live, she had been knitting two socks at a time and showed me how to do it. I thought it was brilliant. It's awesome. It's such a great skill to have if you want to bang out two socks at a time. But for me, it's not my favorite method of knitting socks. I found it incredibly fiddly, way too slow. I really prefer just knitting, one sock right after the other as opposed to two socks at a time. But I did give it a try, so who knows, maybe I'll revisit at a later date. But when I did try it, I got the hang of it. It was totally fine. It was just, I wasn't feeling it. Okay, so these are podcast related questions now, and Teenit Pearl, hi Tanya, wants to know, what's been some of your favorite podcast moments over the years? Has there ever been something you cut out that you wish you didn't, or at the time you shared something you wish you hadn't? There are many times when I cut out things that I wish I hadn't said, which is the beauty of editing, right? Because again, I am not the best conversationalist. I'm generally very quiet, even though it might not appear so, and sometimes when I talk, my filter is nowhere to be found. So when I'm listening back, when I edit the podcast, there are some things that I just cut out because I'm just like, Kristen, what the heck were you saying there? So thankfully, through the beauty of editing, I'm able to cut out those things or rearrange things so I actually come across as saying what I had originally intended to say. I would say like some of my earlier podcasts are nothing to write home about, even though they are kind of lost in the interweb somewhere, but not on purpose or anything. They just happen to be lost. Otherwise I would have left them up there for all you to enjoy in all its dorky glory. But anyway, but otherwise I think thanks to editing, I'm able to cut out certain things. But honestly, I know that I'm speaking to a lot of people right now around the world, and you know, there are certain things which I prefer to keep private, and some things that I prefer, you know, some things that I'm comfortable sharing and some things that I prefer to keep private. So I think I'm very good about that. And again, this is a non-political podcast. It's a non-religious podcast. This is purely about fiber with a couple of tidbits about my life sprinkled in here and there. So I think I do a relatively good job about that. So, but yeah, otherwise, I'm happy with the way it's turning out. Unraveling an Elephant says, I was wondering, what have you gotten out of or learned from podcasting that you didn't expect when you started or when you were only 10, 50, or 100 episodes in? Podcasting has been truly amazing in many, many ways. I feel like through podcasting, I've met so many friends, very close friends, including Lara from the Dyer's Notebooks and Jinx Yarns, Maria from the Subway Knits podcast are very close friends of mine. Molly from A Homespun House, who lives in Germany, we talk. And then Mina from the Knitting Expat, you know, and I know it seems like, you know, oh, podcasters are so clicky and everything, but it's kind of like, you know, because we watch each other's podcasts, we're influenced by each other, and we, you know, are just naturally just gravitate towards each other and contact each other. Podcasting has definitely created a knitting community. Even people that don't have podcasts in my local area, I've become friends with that knit, and we talk to each other all the time. And it's just been, you know, when I started knitting, I only had friends that were into video editing or music, or, you know, they have no concept about, you know, or a need to love fiber or anything like that, or knitting. So it was really great being able to grow my own knitting community through podcasting, and yeah, so that is definitely something that I hadn't really expected or, you know, anticipated when I started podcasting. I just did it for fun, you know, as a way to just express myself through, you know, share what I've been working on, and whoever wanted to follow along was welcome to. But it definitely grew into something so much more meaningful, so much more special, and I'm definitely glad that I started podcasting. And, you know, if you are thinking about it, I highly recommend it, you know, because even if, you know, you live in the middle of nowhere where no one knits or anything, you know, the internet is a big place, you know, and the knitting community is far and wide, so highly recommend it. And I apologize if I am sweating or shiny. It is very hot in here and I can't turn the air conditioner because my camera will pick it up. And it is very hot out. I think there is actually a heat wave going on right now. But anyway, moving along to sewing related questions. Selma123 from the Two Tangle Skeins podcast. Hi, Selma. She says, how did your sewing journey start and who taught you along the way? Okay, so I would say about a year ago, I had gone shopping. I went to, you know, it was summer. I needed some new summer clothes, and it had been a while since I'd been shopping. So I went to my local haunts. I went to H&M, I went to Forever 21, I went to Zara. Could not find anything that looked good on me for the life of me. I don't know, I just got so frustrated, and I was just like, this stinks. I need, you know, why can't I find anything? And I was just like, you know what, I'm gonna make my own clothes. I know, it's like kind of like, really? Because I really don't know how to sew. The only previous experience in sewing that I had before then was the previous October. I mentioned this, I had gone as Cersei for Halloween, and I had enlisted my sewing friend to come over and show me how to sew this thing together because I was so determined to go as Cersei for Halloween. I will try and post a photo of it here just for reference, but and because I'm super proud of the way it turned out. But yeah, she showed me how to, you know, cut out a pattern, put everything together and everything. But that was a one-off, you know. I was like, oh, this is cool, you know, whatever. And, you know, just in my mind, I was like, there's no way I would ever be able to do this on my own, you know. So she kind of, like, showed me the basics and everything like that. And that's the only experience as far as sewing a whole garment was concerned. But then that summer came around and I was like, screw this, I'm just going to make my own clothes. So I watched a Creative Bug tutorial. Creative Bug is awesome. I think it's like only $5 a month or whatever, but your first month is free or whatever. But you know, so I signed up, got a free class on how to sew your own clothes. There's one, it shows you how to sew a simplicity skirt from start to finish. Granted, the skirt did not turn out perfect, but it was wearable. It didn't look like something that I just, you know, sewed up, you know, it didn't look crappy, if you will. It actually looked wearable, like I bought it from a store, just a little bit too big. So that was definitely encouraging. Very proud of myself. And then it just kind of spawned from there. And since then, I've just been watching a lot of Craftsy classes, Creative Bug classes, reading a lot of blogs, especially Gertie's blog for Better Sewing and her books. I have both Gertie's Ultimate Dress Book, which is her newest one, and then I have Gertie's Book for Better Sewing, which is her first one, and I just ordered her second one, which is Gertie's Everyday Casual, I think. I don't know, but it's casual clothing pattern. So that's pretty much what I've been doing along the way. And it's been a year since I consider, like, actually getting really into sewing. So I hope that answers your question. And let me see. Okay, Penny Schwartz, I hope I'm pronouncing this right. Penny Schwarze, wants to know, why do you like the style of clothes you sew? I love them and wish I could wear them. They look so pretty on you. Thank you. And yeah, it's just about, I definitely go through phases. Like, I'm definitely all about dressing up in costumes and, you know, just, you know, any excuse to dress up, I will jump on it. Even in real, you know, everyday wear, you know, I mean, granted, I do go through those phases where I'm just like, I just want to dress casual, t-shirt, whatever, and a skirt. But my favorite go-to uniform, so to speak, especially during fall and winter, is a dress over black leggings, because I can dress it up, dress it down, what have you. It's easy. And you know, I'm skinny, you know, but sometimes, like, where it doesn't show, where the meat doesn't show up here, it loves to show up down below. So I feel like skirts and dresses, this is why I don't enjoy wearing jeans or pants, because I'm a little bottom heavy, you know, and I feel like skirts definitely help balance that out, if you will. So I definitely love wearing skirts because I feel more comfortable in them, more flattered, especially 1950s wear, you know, like not specifically 1950s, but more retro style dresses, you know, like A-line skirts and fitted tops, and, you know, not to bring up Miss Lavelli again, but I always call her Miss Lavelli, Katie from Inside Number 23. I think she and I share the same aesthetic where it's like we love the retro dresses and vintage style, but yeah, I definitely fluctuate between, like, you know, I like the lacy Victorian inspired dresses, and then I sometimes switch off into retro wear, you know, where it's like the flouncy skirts and everything. Like right now, I think this dress is quite vintage, you know, it has like the vintage pockets and everything. So, but yeah, that's pretty much why I like wearing the things I do. I know it works. I know I look good in it. So, I stick with it, you know? It's like if you find a color that works for you, buy everything in that color, like mauve or gray or black, like I do. So, and let me see, I think that is it. But yeah, any, you basically just, it's again, trial and error. You gotta find what you are comfortable wearing. But if it fits like a glove, 9 out of 10, it's going to look good on you. Okay, so we are on to some miscellaneous questions. And Pasha says, so obviously you like Depeche Mode, The Cure, and I think I noticed a Pixies reference, but it isn't coming to me, but what music are you listening to lately? For the record, I listen to The Cure, Pixies, Depeche Mode on a daily basis, so I won't judge if that's what you do also. Viva 80s and 90s gothy alt rock. Yes! Okay, so I listen to all of those. Granted, not on a daily basis, but I do love me some Depeche Mode, Pixies, and The Cure, but I definitely love, I used to be really into, in high school, I used to listen to Smashing Pumpkins nonstop. I used to love grunge. I listened to Hole, I listened to Nirvana, still love them today, and I'm trying to think what else. Today, lately, I mean, I love, like, when I'm walking on the street or going somewhere, commuting, I need to have, like, some pop dance music playing, otherwise it's like, I don't know, I just have to be in the zone when I'm traveling and dealing with crowds and people. And you know, I just like, when I'm more low-key, I like to listen to the low-key stuff, you know, but lately, as of late, I've been listening to a lot of Sia, her latest album. I can just, anything I can sing along or dance to is pretty much what I love. So I've been listening to a lot of Sia. As far as low-key stuff, I've been listening to Chelsea Wolfe. She does a lot of gothy folk. If I had to describe her, she's like goth folk slash pop. I know 2 seasons ago, Game of Thrones used one of her songs as their preview, like for the trailer or whatever. But anyway, I just love her aesthetic. I love her style. And who else? Zola Jesus is another one of them. Another kind of like indie kind of, what do you call it, artist or whatever that does a lot of goth kind of stuff. I do love, I love harpsichord music. I listen to that on occasion. And who else? I know there's somebody else. Who have I been listening to? Let me check my thing. Lana Del Rey. I love Lana Del Rey. She's amazing. What's her name? Amanda Palmer, who's, you know, one of the members of Dresden Dolls, but she had an offshoot, a solo album, which is really good. Still Corners is a really good chill album to listen to. Grimes, I love. I love me some Lady Gaga. I love Arcade Fire. They're really awesome. Gotta love Beyonce. St. Vincent. Fantagram is really awesome. Wolf Alice is something that I'm listening to lately. They have a lot of good tracks on their latest album. Florence and the Machine, CSS. If you haven't heard them, they are pretty, pretty awesome. You should totally listen to them. For some reason, I have a lot of Dragonette on my iPhone, or from my, oh, Likely. I love, love, love Likely. She has some really good stuff out. Definitely give her a listen too. So that's pretty much what I've been listening to these days, or what's actually on my iPhone at the moment. But yeah, love goth, love pop, love anything I can sing or dance along to. So yeah. All That Cake Knit wants to know, do you have any tattoos or piercings? I do not have any tattoos. I do have one piercing. Actually, my ears are pierced, but I do have a navel piercing, which I got in high school. I had actually wanted one of those barbells in my ear, but my mom, for some reason, was like, if you want a piercing, you can only get your navel piercing. You can only get your navel pierced, which I thought was kind of odd, but I was like, I'll take it. So I got my navel pierced. I remember specifically, I went to St. Mark's Place in the Village in New York City with some friends after school and got my navel pierced. And I still have it in today and I love it and I don't regret it at all. Tattoos. I would love to get a tattoo at some point, even though Dennis is kind of on the fence about me getting one. I'm not adverse to the idea. I would love to get something Art Nouveau, especially something, you know, like maybe a unicorn or anything like Art Nouveau styled. I haven't thought about it yet, but a friend told me, you know, if you want to get a tattoo, think about it for a year. If you're still obsessed with the idea of getting this particular tattoo, then go for it. So, but I think I'm coming around to thinking about the type of design that I want. Granted, you know, it's not something that I have my heart set on. I'm not like, I need a tattoo tomorrow or anything like that, but I'd be open to getting one. So I'm not sure where or when or what, but definitely Art Nouveau style or a unicorn or something. I don't know. We'll see. We'll see. The final question is from Pan Within. If you only had 24 hours to spend in Brooklyn, what would you do? Okay, 24 hours to spend in Brooklyn. Wow. Okay, first of all, I'd go to Brooklyn General. Duh. I would go to Maison Premier. That has to be one of my favorite restaurants ever. It's very, when you walk in, it's 1920s, everyone's dressed up, and you feel like you're in a different time era when you go in there. But it's on Bedford Avenue in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, and they are known for their oysters, and they're known for their absinthe cocktails, and I love going to this place for like my birthday or any special occasion. So if I'm doing Brooklyn in 24 hours, you bet your butt I'm gonna go there. So yeah, I would go there, get myself a tuxedo number 2 absinthe cocktail, down some oysters, go to Brooklyn General, buy some yarn, maybe do Brooklyn Flea, pick up some, you know, flea market finds there, and then maybe, where else would I go? Go to Van Leeuwen for ice cream, of course, because they have like really good ice cream here. I would definitely do the Brooklyn Bridge, and then I would go to Mass Brothers and just eat a lot of chocolate. Apparently a lot of eating would happen if I had 24 hours in Brooklyn. I would also have to go to Beacon's Closet, which is a thrift store in Brooklyn. They have several locations, but you know, they have pretty much a lot of great finds there. I found a Betsy Johnson dress, which was originally like $400, marked down to $40. So awesome find, I think. I would go to Gutter, which is a bowling alley, really awesome old bowling alley. You go in there, you feel like you're in the country or somewhere, but really bare bones, really rustic. You go in there, they have a bar and everything. Sometimes they have shows there, but it's a really fun place to go bowling. And then I would also go to a bar with a rooftop because you get a lot of great, like at sunset, obviously. I would definitely maybe go to Berry Park, or there are a couple of other places that have really good roof decks. The Wythe Hotel, I mean, that might be a little hard to get into, but definitely worth the view going up. You can go up, they have a bar up there and you can watch the sunset and everything. That's pretty much all the places that I would hit up. Wow, that was a lot of talking, you guys. That was insane. My throat is gonna kill me tomorrow. But anyways, so worth it. Thank you so much for asking all those wonderful questions. I hope you enjoyed hearing all my answers and are caught up if you are just tuning in as a new viewer. Again, I still have the Ask Away thread. If you have any other questions, you know, regarding the podcast, me, myself, or I, or knitting, or projects, or what have you, that you can always ask me anything in there. So I think that is it for the show. I can't believe it. I feel like I've been talking for eons and eons, but as I mentioned, there's going to be no shop update tomorrow. I will be having another shop update next week, Friday the 15th at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, so stay tuned for that. And if you signed up for the Once Upon a Time Yarn Club, those will be going out very soon, if not next week, the following week. So stay tuned for that as well. And yes, the previous Yarn Club, the Gory Details Yarn Club, those colorways will be made available come August, so that will be soon. And as I mentioned, yes, Vollenbein Yarns will be attending the India Untangled Trunk Show in October, the night before Rhinebeck begins. So cannot wait. Okay, before I forget, I do want to mention some winners from our 200th episode giveaway. We have several prizes that I want to announce. And again, thank you to everybody for all your wonderful, wonderful comments in that thread. I really, truly loved reading through and appreciate everything that you guys have to say. So thank you so much. Again, it's just really lovely reading through that. And yeah, so that thread has since been closed and I selected winners using random.org off camera, but but just go with me. I promise it was completely random, and I chose random winners to go with random prizes that I have up for grabs. So here they are without further ado. So the first winner of a skein of Vollenvine yarns is number 365, Just Brenda. Congratulations. And she says, congratulations on 200 episodes. I've been listening, watching for about 4 years. I love it when you have completed projects to show, especially in sewing. Keep it up. Clearly, I enjoy the entire show, but my favorite moment segment is the blather at the end of every episode. As a native Brooklynite, I love to hear about life in the city specifically and your travels in general. Love it. Thank you so much. And hello to fellow ex-Brooklynite. Once a Brooklynite, you're always a Brooklynite. That's what I say. So, but yes, congrats. You win a skein of Vollenvine yarns. Please PM me on Ravelry, letting me know that you win with your details and which colorway you would like me to dye. And I will get back to you ASAP. And another, since there were so many comments in that thread, I've decided to offer up two skeins of Vollenvine yarns, of my hand-dyed yarn. So the winner of the second skein is number 120, Woolly Features. Congrats on the 200th episodes. I love to see a proper tour of your stash and craft dye studio because you have great taste in decor, and I'm nosy like that, wink. I also love hearing about your inspiration of your designs or yarn, but the podcast is awesome. My fave moment recently was your vlog. I love how quirky it was with the all-out sun protection, haha, as a fellow pale person, I can relate. Yay! So more little random vlogs like that one would be cute too. Glad to see the podcast going strength to strength. Yay, thank you so much. And yes, I definitely want to do some more vlogs. I would definitely love to do another tour of my my craft room and office, or studio as I should call it. I actually prefer to call it a studio. I think that's the more appropriate term. But yeah, definitely that is coming soon. And again, you can definitely check out the podcast that I did with Laura from The Dyer's Notebook, and where we show off like how we're dyeing yarn together in my kitchen. And so that was a lot of fun. Definitely check that out. But yeah, I can definitely see some more you know, vlog behind the scene things coming down the pike. But yes, again, every winner that I win here, please just PM me on Ravelry and I will get back to you ASAP. So yes, congrats again. And yeah, just let me know what colorway you would like. And then we have a wonderful donated project bag by Awesome Granny. And I showed you guys mine. The one that I will be giving away is wrapped up, all ready to go. So, but it's essentially this project bag by Awesome Granny. Wait, bags by Awesome Granny. So thank you so much for the generous prize donation. And yeah, so the winner of that is number 81, Pinhead. And she says, congratulations on your 200th episode. Thank you. I love how you mix knitting with a bit of sewing, but a little bit more spinning would not be unwelcome. I completely agree. I always enjoy the road trips you take. So yay, thank you so much. And I hope you love the, yes, please contact me and I will send you your project bag ASAP. And then we have another winner for the Beyond Vanilla Socks pattern by Mina Phillip of the Knitting Expat Podcast. She's generously donated a collection of her sock patterns, which I am currently knitting one of those patterns here, which is her pebble socks. But I believe there are about like 4 or 5 patterns within the entire collection. So the winner of that is number 228, who is Stricker on Ravelry. And she says, congratulations for such a huge amount of episodes. I did not see all of them yet, not even near, but try to see as many as I can. I also would love to see and hear more about yarn dyeing. Most to hear about every kind of crafty trips, festivals, meetings. They are my favorite moments. So yes, I definitely, as I mentioned, want to do some more vlogging and going out and about and recording more of my experiences. So stay tuned for that. But yes, congratulations, you and Mina's Beyond Vanilla Socks pattern collection. And thank you to Mina for the generous prize offer. As always, she's lovely. So check her podcast out, which is the Knitting Expat Podcast. And then finally, we have a lovely prize donated by So Knit Create. If you remember a couple episodes, I showed you, here's her business card. Naomi, thank you so much for sending this along. She sent one for me and one to one of you lovely viewers, which is this awesome necklace progress. I think it's a combination between a progress keeper, a necklace, and a stitch marker holder, which is really, really lovely. So I'm just gonna put the Pro Business card in there. And the winner of that is number 64, Crystal Tips. And she says, "Hi Kristen, congratulations on getting this far. I've not long started watching the podcast regularly, but I'd love to see some tips and pattern recommendations for beginner sewers." Okay, so I can definitely talk about that in the next episode. I should make note of that. But yeah, congratulations. Again, whoever won, PM me on Ravelry, letting me know your contact and shipping info, and I will get your prizes out to you ASAP. Thank you so much again. And again, so many wonderful comments in there, and it's truly been an awesome experience. 200 episodes and 6 years in. So here's to many more years, and congrats again to all the winners. And thank you to all the wonderful, and those who have donated such wonderful prizes. It really means a lot. And yeah, just keep making the awesome things that you make. Yeah, so that said, I'm gonna move along to blather. And welcome back. I hope you guys enjoyed that segment of AMA as much as I enjoyed answering all of your questions. But now I think we have time for a little bit of blather, where I get to talk about what's been going on in my life. Well, as I mentioned, Dennis and I had gone up to Maine for 4th of July weekend. We had the time off, and it's been quite a while since we've been to Maine. I think the last time we were in Maine was 5 years ago. We had gone the summer that we got married, that August. So we stayed in Harpswell that time, and this time around we stayed in York, Maine. I did post some photos of it on Instagram, and I didn't even mention where we were staying, but a couple of people commented. They're like, you know, is that the Cuddy Sark Motel? And I'm like, why yes it is. We did stay at the Cuddy Sark, which is a really nice motel, I should say. But, you know, we had a full view of the ocean from our room, and that was really lovely. And then we did some trails. We were pretty much beach bums the entire time. Our hotel was right on the beach, so it was easy for us to just get up, hang out at the beach. We did the Marginal Way, which is a trail, although albeit a very manicured trail. It's not full, you know, it's nowhere in nature at all. It's paved and very touristy, but you do get to walk along the coastline and get a nice view. I took lots of video there, so if you're so inclined to stick around at the end of the episode, I am going to include some video of our trip. But yeah, the Marginal Way is really beautiful. We started at the beginning of the trail and walked all the way to the end and had dinner at one of the restaurants there, and then bummed around the town. We ate lobster, that was really nice. And it was Dennis's birthday, so his birthday is on the 2nd. So we got to celebrate his birthday in Maine, which was really nice. And we came back on the 4th of July, and ironically, we hit no traffic, which was wonderful. We came back just in time to watch the fireworks, which is also funny because when we came back from Italy, we came back New Year's Eve just in time for the fireworks. So I'm starting to notice a pattern going on, but yeah, it was just, as I mentioned, a really wonderful time. I got lots of knitting in, and yeah, this weekend I think we are just gonna lay low, enjoy, relax at home. I did get Dennis a birthday present, which included an inflatable kiddie pool. So it could double as a kiddie pool for children and a lounge pool for adults. But last summer our neighbor had purchased one, and you know, I saw it from the window and it looked so much fun. You know, it's a good place to like just dip your feet in and stay cool. And especially this summer, our friends had gotten one too. We barbecued at their place and they had gotten an inflatable pool. I'm like, you know what? Why not? We have a backyard and everything. So I got this round inflatable pool. It has like little holders for, you know, your drinks and whatnot. So it's Friday. I might inflate the pool and fill it with water and just chill out and knit on the deck. I don't know. We'll see. But I'm very excited to give it a go because it's quite hot out. I think after I'm done recording this, I'm gonna pump the AC on because yeah. Although I do want to get some dyeing done today. But anyway, yeah, so again, we're probably just going to relax this weekend, hang out at our lounge and our pool. in the lake. So I might include footage of that. I don't know. We'll see. But anyway, I think I've talked for quite a while this episode, so I'm gonna leave it there. Until next time, happy knitting, and I'll see you next time. Although I wish Bella would have made an appearance, but she's trying to stay cool as well. So anyway, I'll leave it there. Happy knitting. I'll see you next time. Bye.